It's Absolute Radio, and tonight in session on Hometime, the travelling band. Hello, gentlemen.
Hello.
Hello. It's been a while. What has it been, about 18 months since you were last in here playing your wares?
Yeah, I don't know where all that time's gone, to be honest.
And are things good in the travelling band? Have any rifts or schisms opened amongst you?
Well, yeah, we've split up at least three times. Steve formed a new karaoke company, but then we persuaded him to come back.
And you lured him back into the band.
Yeah, he was making a lot of money, though, with it, let's be honest. But, you know, he wanted to make the second album, so he's back.
That's fine.
Good to have you back. What is your karaoke song of choice, Steve?
I'd probably say it's like Club Tropicana, maybe something like that, or Wild Thing, maybe, you know.
So is Steve like the most liked member of the band, or is he most disliked member of the band within the band? Who do you all gang up on?
We're pretty mellow. I'd say like I can get the most mean, probably, if I'm not getting my way.
Joe's got this thing called the Death Stare.
The Death Stare.
So, like, basically, like, if we make a wrong note, it's like that James Brown thing, you know, when he used to, like, fire the musicians if they made a note, or fine them $40 or whatever.
Have you tried finding the other members of the band?
He beats us with freshly buttered baguettes if we do anything wrong.
Can you give me an example of the Death Stare? Oh, God. let's turn straight away then, listeners. Not good.
It doesn't scare me.
You're just saying that.
Even the sound engineer at the back of the gigs can often be reached by the Death Stare.
It crosses continents. It's been known.
I saw it on Superman 3, and I've been working on it ever since.
You've done very well. Was that the one with the alien people who lived on the moon?
Yeah.
The three baddies.
Zod.
Yeah, he does look a bit like Zod, doesn't he? Is that you modelled yourself on Zod?
I have. I'm looking to get a bit bit bigger.
Either that or Joe 90.
A sort of fusion of the two. Now, you're a Manchester band, but you're down in London at the moment. You're working at Abbey Road Studios.
Yeah, we are. It's pretty exciting, actually. We're mastering a 7-inch that we're putting out with the 2 Pure label in August, and we get to do it at Abbey Road. So
is that an exciting place to be? Are you aware of the history of the place? Does it live up to expectations?
Well, we've not been in there. We're in there tomorrow, so we've not been in there yet. Let me tell you something.
You go in, and you know that smell of an old church hall or an old school hall? It's got that smell of history about it. It's probably like, it's all there underneath the parquet floorboards. Yeah. That's where
I'm looking forward to finding some of Ringo's old toenails or something like that. I don't know. It's one of the things to do before we die, ticked off the list.
Hey, I had a question for you related to the Beatles, actually. Well, vaguely. I was wondering, have you ever been in a record shop and seen one of your records next to a Travelling Wilburys record?
My dad bought...
When our distributor wasn't bust, when our first record came out, my dad bought our first record under the payment from HMV, and he said it was next to the Travelling Wilburys.
I've actually seen it next to a Tom Petty record, which is close enough.
Yeah, he's another one of the Travelling Wilburys.
Indeed, he is.
You're strangely linked in the cosmos. Yeah. Now, you were recently on the soundtrack of that Ian Dury film, and you were the only people who weren't the blockheads on that soundtrack. How did that happen?
Basically, we got a call from a guy I know who directed it called Matt Whitecross. He's a fan of the band, and it was quite last minute. And what tends to happen with a lot of these low-budget indie films is they run out of money, and then whoever it was that they wanted to get for the soundtrack goes, well, you know, you're going to have to pay us. And then we got a phone call saying, do you want to do it? And we were like, yeah, of course we do, because, you know, we're used to not having any money anyway, so we appreciate what you're saying. And he said, well, in return, I'll make a music video for you.
Brilliant.
So that's happening in the next couple of weeks.
That's great. So you're going around undercutting other bands for soundtrack work.
Well, I wouldn't say that. I mean, you know, if anyone's listening, we actually do want to get paid for soundtrack work. But this was a special case, because we really believed in the film, and it is just an incredible film. And I think
it is a great film. Did you get to go to the premiere or anything like that then?
We didn't. We weren't around, actually. Obviously, they don't do many premieres in Manchester. I don't know why, because obviously it's the centre of the
universe.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. The film community, people think of Manchester as the place to be.
It's those big white signs on that big white sign on Werneth Low saying Manchester.
I think it's since they knocked the Withington cinema down, we lost all the premieres.
You've got a couple of bog standard guitars with you tonight, and then I can see a banjo. What's this one here? Is this a mandolin?
This is a mandolin, yeah. My mother bought me this, and I think last time I was here, I slagged off the mandolin that my mum bought me.
You did? You said it had been beaten up and damaged.
It's still working, and it's the same strings as that was on it 18 months ago, so it must be all right. So if you're listening, Mum, I'm really sorry about last time. I do love the mandolin.
It's definitely developed a soul since we were last here.
It has.
I think
it's got the duende.
Yeah,
it's got the what?
The duende.
What's the duende?
Duende is like a flamenco term that refers to finding. It's like the dark, deepest dark moment of the creative's mind when he or she finds that inner kind of
wow.
The opening bit. Of the door to the
wow. The duende. Yeah. It is. It's a mandolin with the duende. Are there any other instruments that you fancy that you've not yet used? Because you've used lots of different bits and pieces. Have you ever used a dulcimer or a lute? It's a bit medieval.
We've used...
we've got an auto harp on the new record.
Yeah. Oh, they're nice, yeah.
I've never played a lute, though.
We've been looking for a Hilbert Clipper, actually, for the last couple of years, but we haven't...
What's a Hilbert Clipper?
It's a discombobulator that you put through the dual compression at the end of recording.
Actually, I know exactly... I can visualise one now.
Rare, good old
Hilbert.
Yeah. Have you ever played any sort of hardcore folk gigs?
We supported Donovan in, where was it? France somewhere.
Cannes,
yeah. He's pretty folk.
Yeah, he doesn't really wear any jumpers anymore.
Are you talking pipes here?
Yeah, that's exactly the sort of thing. Aaron knit sweaters.
We're not really accepted by the folk community. Yeah.
Have you been ostracised?
Well, yeah, I don't know. I just don't think we're...
We've played for Whiskey in the Isle of
Wight. We're the bad boys of folk.
I think it's because they don't appreciate... we've pioneered this new genre, crunk folk. And Pete Seeger was on the phone the other day and he was just like, Joe... He's like, Joe, this reminds me of Dylan, Newport Folk Festival.
We had him on loudspeaker, you could hear him sharpening up the axe.
Cut the power. And I was like, Pete, there isn't any power. This is a folk show. We've been ostracised by the folk community. But honestly, I think the only folk gigs we ever get to do, I think Moseley Folk Festival, but we never get booked for folk gigs. But maybe it's because we play electric guitars.
Did I just miss something? Did you say that you played for Whiskey instead of Money once?
Yeah, we went to our new record that we've been making over the last year. We did the first half of it for our drum sound on the Isle of Mull in a converted church, and we didn't drink for a whole week.
Wow.
And then the last night we blew it.
And the Craig
we
you're
actually
in.
Played for Whiskey in a pub and drank about 3 or 4 bottles of it.
And bearing in mind we played over 350 songs that night, you can imagine.
And then the next day
that's
we
a
missed
folk
the ferry.
Yeah, what is folk anyway? Our answers on our postcard, because I'm still trying to work out what it is.
Just don't send the postcards here, send them to the band. Thanks so much for coming and playing for us. So so the single's available for download now, and then what next?
What next? Well, we've got a live album out too, called Arrears Not Careers, which pretty much sums up the music industry at the moment. But well, for us anyway. But and that's out, and then the album should be out in October, I think. So.
And people can see it at festivals over the summer as well.
Yeah, we're playing Glastonbury, the Park Stage, and we're also doing the Witchwood Festival, Beat Herder Music with a View Festival, a few others, and we're going to France in August. So for. What's it called? The festival Le Nuit d'Or.
Le Nuit d'Or, yeah. In Montpellier. So
we're trying to look for a gig on the way down, actually. So if anyone's listening and wants to book us in France in August, get in touch.
There we go. On the postcard, please.
On the postcard, yeah.
Great. Well, thanks so much for coming and playing for us. Travelling band.
Thanks very much.
Thanks for having us.